sink real bad. And now I'm doing shows in Helsinki. I know what you're thinking that you can outthink me, but you can't, frankly. I'm out for the Benjis, Frankie. You know, just cause you ain't me, don't hate me. As a matter of fact, you should thank me. Even if you don't, you're welcome, Yankees. Digga, 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 zow. Who got the keys to the world now? Yours truly, blah.
Thank you. You wake up in the morning and listen to Pitbull. It's an honor to be here with you today. I was able to do some recruiting yesterday, and you speak to various groups, and all of a sudden your phone starts to go off, and you realize that you know people in the audience. And my executive assistant with the Boston Celtics, Jeff Noyes, is out there, and my son just texted me, who's the head coach of Minnesota, and said his neighbor Mark Flanagan is here. And then my phone started blowing up, so welcome to all of you. I just finished a book about 7 months ago. It was my fifth motivational book. This one meant more to me than any other book because I really wrote it for myself, where the other books I wrote were for someone else. And here's the interesting thing about the book. It happened with something negative in my life. So I'm always motivating people to try and help them reach their potential. That's our business, and that's every team's business. So 3 years ago, and I know some of you follow, at least some of the people into college basketball follow March Madness. And last year you watched Duke lose to Mercer College. I asked a question walking out after I saw the upset on television, what state is Mercer located? And someone looked at me and said, you really don't know where they're at? I said, no, I think it's Arkansas maybe. And they said, no, it's Georgia. They're really good. I said, well, they must be. They just beat Duke. And he said, you're not serious, are you? I said, no, game just ended. They beat Duke. Well, 3 years ago, now 4 years ago, we're playing Morehead State. Morehead State's not a common name, and you probably don't know where it's at, but it's in Kentucky. And I'm watching them on film and saying, this team is really good. They have a person on the team named Kenneth Faried. No one in Louisville ever heard of Kenneth Faried. From New Jersey today, he just signed about a month ago a $60 million contract with the Denver Nuggets. One of the premier rebounders in the league, represented our country in the Olympic Games this summer, the pre-Olympic Games. And he's an awesome player, and he was on the team, but he didn't have a reputation yet. They also had four other outstanding players. Well, it's okay, we're in control of the game. With 4 minutes to go in the game, we're up eight. My best player breaks his ankle. We put in a walk-on. We had no backup for him. And we're up two with 15 seconds to go. It's their ball. They call a timeout. They go down the court. They wait 5 seconds, 4 seconds, 3 seconds. Young man shoots a three. Goes in. We lose the game. We obviously congratulate Morehead State. Difficult loss, losing in the first round. But we won 25 games that year, had a very good season. We reached our potential in my mind. So the next day I go home and plotting out the strategy for the future. My son calls me and says, you want to have lunch, Dad? My oldest son. I said, sure, where do you want to meet? Sit down, he's shaking his head. I said, what's wrong? He said, boy, talk radio's killing you, Dad. The internet's blowing up with people saying you're too old, you lost your touch, you can't recruit anymore. I said, wait a second, Mike, who's saying this? He said, I have no idea who's saying it. It's people on the radio, nameless people. I said, so you're listening, you're a coach's son, and you're listening to the fellowship of the miserable. And he said, yes. I said, Mike, do you realize what is the unemployment rate today? At the time, he said 7.5%. I said, that's where they roam every day. On the radio, on the internet. People who work don't have time for that. Why are you wasting your time? He said, Dad, I'm just telling you what they're saying about you. So obviously, I didn't feel great. I said, you know what? I'm now coaching 38 years, professional in college. I'm going to look into going into broadcasting. The business is changing. I didn't like it at all. So I fly to New York. I meet with ESPN, CBS. I get a great package to do college basketball and some other events. I'm all excited, all pumped up. And I go back home and my wife says, you really going to do this? I say, yes, it's going to be awesome. And I'm real pumped up, very excited. I'm telling her why it's going to be so good. So let me get this straight. You had a conversation with your son about nameless people saying you're too old for this business. And you lost the game and were upset. And that's the way you handle losing. I said, no, I've been handling losing for a long time. So you're going to give up on everything for one game. I said, no, you're not listening to my rationale. It's 38 years of coaching. And now it's time. I'm excited to start a new venture. She said something else. Because in another chapter in a book, I wrote, I'd rather live one day as a lion than 1,000 as a lamb. And she said, I didn't know I married a so-and-so lamb. And I thought about that. I thought about it for the next 48 hours. And I said, she was right. But I had to reinvent myself because I was definitely not too old. I had to start something fresh, a different culture. Because our cultures change in business all the time. As they do in your industry, and as they do in the world of college basketball. Everything changes. So I started writing a book, and it was based on a comment that my brother-in-law and friends made in a Wall Street tavern when I was the New York Knicks coach in 1987. It came across the ticker that a young man was just given an offer sheet to the Atlanta Hawks for $21 million, $3 million a year. He averaged 2 points a game, 2 rebounds a game. They were all laughing. Why would they offer this young man that much money when he averages 2 points a game? I said, it's based on potential. He's 6'11". He said, potential? He said, let us tell you about our business. One bad trade, one mistake with a trade, and we're out of a job. We are only as good as our last trade, and we live on a one-day contract, not a 7-year, $21 million contract. I said, what do you mean a one-day contract? He said, well, the guy next to me just had a bad trade, lost the firm a lot of money. He was called in to what he called the principal's office, and they told him he's fired. He wasn't allowed to go back to his desk and clean it out. Security escorted him out of the business. He was there for 10 years and sent the stuff in the mail. He couldn't go back to his computer. I said, you're kidding me. No, definitely true. We live on a one-day contract. And I started thinking about it. What would life for me as a coach who now has a 10-year contract and 7 remaining be like on a one-day contract? How would I prepare the night before? How would I wake up in the morning? How would I coach my players? Now remember this, the contract is with the person in the mirror. And I don't always get my contract renewed. Most of the time I do. But it's based on my performance every single day. So I'm asking you right now to think about signing on to a one-day contract, as I did 3 years ago, because the results have been outstanding the last 3 years since writing this book. The last 3 years we've had the class that I've coached had the most wins in the history of the University of Louisville. Back-to-back Final Fours, Sweet 16, national championship, three straight regular season conference championships, three straight playoff championships. And I'm convinced it's because of the philosophy of the one-day contract that got us to reach our potential. Our theme was, if we play for the front of the jersey and give everything we can for the team, the name on the front, your company, the name on the back will prosper. So a two-star athlete, Russ Smith, just to give you an idea, we base our rankings on a 1 to 5+, 5+ being LeBron and Kobe, 5-star being young man Rose from Chicago Bulls. I had a 2-star athlete that doesn't belong at Louisville. Russ Smith came as a freshman. Gave him a nickname, Rusticulous. Russ Smith is a 2-star athlete, wanted to transfer because he didn't think he could play at Louisville. After winning a national championship, back-to-back Final Fours, Russ Smith today is playing for the Pelicans, but more important, became a first-team consensus All-American. And the one-day contract is, Russ, you just give me everything you can. That one fist, part of a basketball team, playing, doing everything possible for the name Louisville, and the name on the back, Smith, will prosper. But you have to play for the team and everything you can. So the one-day contract starts, and here's how you sign on. Tonight, you prepare your company, your business, and yourself for the next day, because preparation is a major key to winning. Now it gets good. The next morning you wake up and you're a different person. The one-day contract does not allow for cynicism, moodiness, rudeness. It only allows for turning people on to your dynamic personality. And you may be sitting there right now and saying, I don't have a dynamic personality. Yes, you do. Because if you don't turn it on, your contract is not getting renewed. So it's the way you start work. And I used to start work by getting my staff together, telling them that if we don't start working hard and preparing better, we're going to have to obviously get in at 4 o'clock, work around the clock, and basically threaten them with a work ethic that's unattainable. Now I start out personally, and I don't turn on the television in the morning. I do 12 minutes on an elliptical, just before the show, only 12 minutes, just to get started. Then I turn on my radio, and I listen to Armando Christian Perez, Pitbull. And I get fired up for my 10-minute drive to work. I stop at Starbucks, I buy everybody coffee. The staff sits around, I tell them they did an awesome job yesterday in practice. Let's get better today. We've got terrific potential on this team. Everybody feels great. We start the day. I started not by patronizing them, but by telling them how much I appreciate their incredible work ethic. Then we go about our job. We all exercise at lunchtime. We all try to stay in the shape, mentally and physically, necessary to get our contract renewed. Everybody we come across is extremely significant. And here's the problem with the one-day contract. See this? This is a trap. The trap of technology. It's a great phone. Yesterday in Tampa, going to a recruit's high school, we just punched in the directions, took us right to the high school. Then it told us the best restaurant in Tampa and how to get there. All my emails, everything's right here. Rankings, ratings, anything I want to find out is at my fingertips. And that's great. Awesome device. But it's also a trap. And I call it in the book of one-day content, the trap of technology. We are all, in some way or fashion, in the business of sales. We sell ourselves, we sell our team. The better athletes I recruit, the better coach I become. The better talent you surround yourself in your industry, the better your organization. Well, I see it quite often. I'm in a group, and I'm talking to very significant people, and I'd love to meet all of you personally. Then all of a sudden, somebody takes out their phone and starts texting. Or, like 2 weeks ago, I couldn't believe, of all places, I'm in a Catholic church at Mass, someone's phone rings, mistake, you think we'd turn it off? He stands up, walks down the aisle, and says hello, in church. I was blown away by it. The trap of technology, here's the rule. When we go to dinner, no one takes their phone out. If someone does, they pay the check. With the college team, I tell them no phone at dinner. We are to interact. Learn to master the art of communication by speaking. Sure enough, Russ Smith took his phone out. During the NCAA tournament, he was reading Twitter. He said, Coach, I was just checking. Russ, give it to me. It's a way for the next 24 hours. You would have thought I was making him run in the Sahara Desert because I took that phone away. It's a trap. First and foremost, on a one-day contract, the person you're dealing with is the most significant person in life. You never lose your focus or get distracted from that person. I had something very unique happen to me 2.5 years ago. I get a phone call from someone that tells me the owner of this professional team on the West Coast wants to offer me the general manager's job. I said, why me? He said many years ago, he was an assistant women's coach for a JV high school team. You were in the Final Four, and he met you in the lobby and said, he came rushed up to you, and he knew you were in a rush and said, could you show me the principles of your full court press? And I said, do you have a pad, sir? He said, yes. I said, let's sit down for 10 minutes. And I sat down with him, and I said, here are the main things. And they said, so nice of you, I remember it, so nice of you to do this. I know you're in a rush to practice. I said, well, if you have the basketball players to do this, I think you'll have a lot of success. Walked off, and some 25 years later, this man became a billionaire, owns a professional team, calls up and offers me a job. I said, all because I took the time to sit down with him. He said he never forgot it. Well, every single person that you interact with a one-day contract, is the most significant person you're going to meet for that moment. And you don't get distracted and lose your focus with this trap of technology. We must understand to master the art of communication, which is the ability to listen 4 times to the amount you speak. So I had a problem the other day in practice because my players don't understand the force of focus, the ability not to pick up a phone, the ability to read a chapter without looking up, the ability to look someone in their eyes and not get distracted at all, the ability to look at an offensive basketball play and concentrate. I called up a good friend of mine from Eastern Kentucky who's in his late 80s, and he asked about the team, and I said, these guys get so distracted, they can't focus. He said, Coach, it's part of my generation too. It's part of me. I didn't listen to my dad and always got into trouble when he told me not to do it. I said, well, what do you mean? Your generation, you listened. He said, listen, let me tell you a story. Many years ago, my dad kept telling me at a young age, I was 19, whatever you do, don't go across the river. There's things across the river, remember this is 60 years ago, that you don't want to see. I'm not going to go into what's across the river, but you could imagine. He said, promise me, not at least until you're 21, do not cross that river. So the young man and his friend kept telling each other, he said, my dad just keeps telling me not to cross that river. And there's things I just don't want to see across the river. And he keeps repeating that. And the friend said, oh, I don't listen to you. Dad, let's go across the river. He said, I can't. I promised my dad I'd wait to 21. He said, don't go there. There are things that you just don't want to see at a young age. I said, so what did you do, LD? Did you listen to him? He said, no, that's the point. Of course not. I said, you went across the river? He said, yes. I said, LD, what did you see? He said, my daddy. Well, and that's the force of focus. You must listen. There's things you don't want to see. Well, the ability to master that art of communication is so crucial. The ability to listen is what sales is all about. It's about motivation. I remember with Billy Donovan, my assistant coach at the University of Kentucky, came off a Final Four and he said, Coach, we're going to Memphis. If we get this kid, we're leading with him, Coach. We're his number one school for 2 years. We get this kid, we'll get back to another Final Four. Billy was all excited. I said, relax, Billy, we'll get him. I walk in the home, parents, brother, sister, high school coach. I start talking about the Roman Empire of college basketball, Kentucky. The most wins in the history of the game. 56 All-Americans, 24,000 people every night. You travel on a private plane to all your games. You're on television every night. You don't live in a dormitory. You live in the Wildcat Lodge. 45 minutes are up, and I noticed everybody on their legal pad had questions. So I said, see, you all have questions. You could hear a pin drop for 45 minutes. It's now their turn. Dad, what do you have? Well, Coach, I had 8 questions. I don't have any anymore. You answered them all. Mom? Coach, I had 7 questions. You covered every one. Coach, I know you must have some basketball questions. No, Coach. You talked about your style, how you're going to use Deuce. You talked everything. I couldn't get 1 question. I said, well, I guess that's it. Thanks so much for having us in your home. We walked out. I was somber. Billy said, Coach, that was great. They were mesmerized for 45 minutes. I said, Billy, great. They didn't have 1 question. He said, yeah, you covered everything, Coach. I said, no, I didn't, Billy. I never interacted. Billy, I never formed the bond, built the trust. I never listened. And I never would forget his response to me that day. He said, Coach, you're reading too many of those motivational books. We're in great shape. I said, we're not. After 2 years of hard work, we called the next day to set up a college visit, become 1 of 5 that a person can take. We didn't even get the visit. 2 years of work down the drain. Billy says, let's go back to Lexington. I said, no, let's go in on that young man that you said we have no shot at from Brownsville, Tennessee. He said, Coach, he's down to Arkansas, Memphis, and Tennessee. We haven't called him, we haven't written him. I said, let's go in. We walk in, 2 parents, 2 brothers that played Division II basketball, high school coach and girlfriend. I immediately asked Mom a question about his studies. She went on a dissertation how he can't major in communication. He must major in business. I asked the brothers a question. I said, those 3 schools that are recruiting, Tony, I want to try to play him at point guard. They're all recruiting him as a 2 guard. They both speak for 10 minutes about at 6'1", if he doesn't learn to play the point, he has no shot at the NBA. I tell the high school coach, I saw you play last year. You ran 2 great plays for a 3-point shot. I take out my magnetic clipboard. Could you show me the plays? He starts diagramming the plays. All of a sudden, it's 1.5 hours of listening. Billy goes, gotta catch a flight. The mom says, I'm sorry, Coach. I haven't offered any of you something to drink, and we're gonna barbecue. Would you like to stay? I says, without question. We barbecue, we stay for 2 hours and 45 minutes. We miss our flight. We have to drive 5.5 hours, rent a car, and get home. Billy says, what was that all about as we walk out? All those questions, staying for a barbecue, missing our flight, you never talked about where he's going to live, who we're playing, how many people go to a game. I said, Billy, don't you think they already know that? You know what happened in that living room, Billy? We got all those people to like what we represent. All because we formed the bond, paid their respect of listening. We told them they're more important than we are. By mastering the art of communication, listening. He shook his head. We called him up the next day. That weekend, we got a visit. Everybody in that room came because they said the visit we had was unbelievable. We did nothing but listen, smile, eat with them, build trust. He called us on Sunday after the visit, committed to us. The fascinating thing about it, as I look back, the young man from Memphis hurt his knee, tore his ACL, transferred schools. Tony Delk played 11 years in the NBA, was the MVP at a 96 championship, wasn't even on our radar, all because we went in at home, and the number one rule of sales is listen. And if you can do that, you'll really know what roads to travel, you'll know what to bring up, what to say, and you'll definitely know how to create friendships. And that's part of the one-day contract, the ability to listen, the ability to focus in on what the problem is, what the solution is. Now, on a one-day contract, you're not allowed to give excuses because excuses are a sign of weakness. We give no excuses when we fail. Failure is just fertilizer to help us grow as a team. We make no excuses. We say the other team was better that night, but tomorrow we become better than them. So we're not allowed to be cynical. We're not allowed to be moody, and we can't make excuses on a one-day contract because we have to get renewed. So can you imagine all of you in this room waking up tomorrow, understanding it's going to be the best day that you're ever going to encounter? You're going to treat people with the greatest respect by listening. You're going to motivate them through great enthusiasm. You're going to put a lot of confidence and belief in them. And then when you go home, you're going to renew your contract by being with your family and being the best dad, the best husband, the best wife, the best friend you can possibly be to get your contract renewed. Now, along those lines, I mentioned the word adversity. And we're all going to encounter it. I've had more than I want to even mention. But for all of you who face adversity, personal as well as professional, we know on a one-day contract you're going to get through it. You will get through it. Adverse conditions we can handle. But success is another thing. Success, like technology, can hurt people. And I've learned, see, when I was in my 30s as the head coach of the Knicks, I don't know if you realize this from my bio, but I invented the game of basketball. Did you know that? Well, that's what I thought in the 30s. I thought I was pretty darn special, as most young people do. Well, the number one chapter in the book is humility. Humility is the key to success. Because some people, when they get successful, along the way get a degree of arrogance, thinking it's them and they're the reason the team wins. It's not. We win because of the team. And if you hire people, try and hire people who are even better at what you do than yourself. Surround yourself with dynamic people who are willing to play for that name on the front. Humble people. When I flew to New York to meet with 6 different brokerage firms to invest money for one of my players, I met with JP Morgan, Goldman Sachs, all of them, and I came across a gentleman named Mario Gabelli in Rye, New York. And I tried to sound intelligent, went in his back room and saw all these men and women trading equities on a little TV monitor. And I said to him, where do you get your talent? University of Chicago, Harvard Business School, Wharton School at Pennsylvania? His answer was fascinating to me, and I've maintained it as part of my repertoire for years. He said, no, I look for PhDs. I said, that's strange, PhDs for Wall Street. He said, I look for poor, hungry, and driven people. I don't care where they go to school. Well, I changed it. Today, I only try to recruit PhDs, and I took the poor away because my players don't want to hear that. Passionate, hungry, driven people. The ones that are humble are the ones that reach their potential. The ones that find success very early on and think it's because of them don't reach their potential. Humble people understand why you win. Humble people listen. Humble people understand what the team is all about. It's a family. It's one fist, and no one's more important than the other. Everybody on a one-day contract is treated with great dignity and respect. Well, of course, my greatest regret today, when people ask me, what is it? Was it the Duke game when Christian Laettner hit that shot? Was it the Boston Celtics when you didn't take it to the level you hoped to? I said, no, my greatest regret, because I'm on a one-day contract, was not being more humble at a younger age. Because humility is a big key to success. It helps you understand what you're all about and how to give credit to others way before yourself. And when you do that, that name on the back, which is yourself, really starts to prosper. Humility, opening chapter. The last chapter is kind of interesting because it deals with humility and puts together everything in the book. It's called Building a Bridge, and we all do it. Every team, every company builds a bridge. For me, it started really at Providence College as a head coach. And I was judging people back then because, remember, I had all the answers. I was a young coach. Judging who's going to be good, who's not going to be good. And one of my assistant coaches said, I'd like to recommend, we had an opening for a graduate assistant. All they get paid is room, board, books, and tuition, just like a scholarship, and they get to work on their master's degree while they work 14 hours a day doing all the dirty work of the team. So I said, yeah, sure, introduce me to this young man. He was a JV coach at a high school. He came in, and I looked at him, and it was quite obvious he never played basketball. He was too short. Even at a very young age, he was losing his hair. He was very thin, and I just felt he couldn't command the respect of a college basketball player. My assistant argued with me, no, he has the strongest work ethic, Rick. Don't judge his book by its cover. I said, well, I try not to do that, Stu, but I don't know. I don't know if the players would ever listen to him. He said, Coach, his work ethic is incredible. Well, I hired him. He was right. He beat us all the work every day. We got in at 6:30. He slept on my couch so he would be there beforehand. He outworked everybody. Everybody understood what he was all about, and they didn't care what he looked like, if he ever played ball, or what his resume was. They just knew how hard he worked for that name on the front. Years later, he became a professional basketball coach. His name is Jeff Van Gundy. Today, he's the number one analyst on television. Never judge anyone unless you know their work ethic, their passion, how hungry they are, how much they want to share with others. Then I had a young man write me a letter, tell me he wants to learn the full court press at Kentucky to be a student manager. I wrote him back, I said, Frank, you're from New Jersey and Kentucky's probably 98% Kentuckians. They speak almost a foreign language. They're not going to understand you. You're not going to understand them. So why don't you call Rutgers, Seton Hall, Princeton, and those schools and become a student manager there? He says, no, I really want to learn the style of play that you guys implemented. I said, okay, come on in. You're one of 11 managers. He worked his butt off after 4 years. He says, can I be a grad assistant? Sure. Moves his way up to assistant video guy. Travels with me to the Boston Celtics video person. Today he's Frank Vogel, the head coach of the Indiana Pacers. One of my other players at Boston University is the head coach of the Philadelphia 76ers. Another player I coach is the head coach of the Dallas Mavericks, Rick Carlisle. On and on, about 30 managers, players, and assistant coaches are head coaches in college, head coaches in the pros. See, the bridge that we have and we've built is a crowded one, full of successful people that have helped me build a team. And I've prospered because of them. And they've prospered because our bridge is crowded with people that play for that name on the front. And for all of us who are looking to reach our potential, our individual potential, our team potential, it's all about starting out with great humility and understanding why you win, and then helping people cross over that bridge to share in the success that you're experiencing. It's crucial for understanding what a team is all about and an organization. Humility and building that bridge. It truly does raise the self-esteem of every person when that bridge is crowded. When you gain success and your bridge is empty, there's a void in your life when you don't have a crowded bridge, when your family is not part of that success. It's crucial for all of us because that's the essence of a one-day contract, to make those around you lift them up to greater heights that they never thought they could reach. Billy Donovan, the young man I talked about in Florida, at Providence College, when we took over, averaged 4 minutes a game. Came in to see me and wanted to transfer. I said, where to? He said, Northeastern and Fairfield. I have to tell you and own up to it today, I was so excited to get his scholarship, to give it to a player that could actually play the game. I called up both coaches and said, look, I've got a Big East player for you wanting to take a step down and transfer to your school. What's his name? Billy Donovan. Can't play for me. He's not good enough. Too slow. He's overweight. Well, Billy waddled back in at about 6 o'clock that day. 190 pounds, 5'11 and a half. I said, Billy, you're a little overweight, aren't you, for a basketball player? He said, yeah, coach, I haven't played that much in practice. Coach Mullaney doesn't use the 11th and 12th man, and I'm a lot of shape. I said, do you drink beer? He said, no. He said, I just eat poorly. He said, which school wanted me more, Fairfield or Northeastern? I looked at him and didn't have the heart to tell him that neither school thought you could play at a lower level. I said, let me ask you a question. How much do you love this game? He said, I love it, coach. I said, let's go in the gym. I want you to take 4 months now as you leave for the summer, and I want you to work on the following things. I also want you to lose 31 pounds. I weighed him, he was 191. Get down to 160, because we're going to press and run, come back in great shape and work on these fundamentals. Comes back after Labor Day. He's our third guard now, and we win. The following year, he takes a picture. He's going to be the captain. And I said, Billy, I want you to do something. I want you to put on a cowboy hat, little handkerchief around your neck, guns, spurs, and boots. He said, coach, this is embarrassing. I look like a little kid. I said, you are a kid. You are now, in the caption read on the cover of the press guide, Billy the Kid, the fastest gun in the East. Still to this day, on his 40th birthday, his wife sent out, Billy's a kid no longer, come celebrate his 40th birthday. From that point on, he was always known as Billy the Kid, but he believed in it. He believed he evolved into this great basketball player who paid the price. I have to tell you, He led a very average, mediocre team, the most mediocre team I've ever coached, to the Final Four. The second Final Four in the history of Providence College, and he became the star from a 4.4 minutes a game basketball player who never got into practice in a 2-year period. One-day contract, it's really what we're all about, but I left out the most important thing about the one-day contract. I started out telling you how I was gonna leave for another job because of cynical negative people saying I was so old. The fascinating thing about it is I've never enjoyed coaching any more in a 41-year period than I do today. I am so fired up to get to practice this afternoon. Opening game of the season next Friday, I hope you'll tune in. The number one game on television starting off the college basketball season is Minnesota versus Louisville in the armed service game in Puerto Rico. Louisville versus Minnesota. Who's coaching Minnesota? My ex-assistant coach, also my son. So it's father versus son, first game of the season. And I didn't want to play the game. I felt it would tear our family apart at the game. I said, Richard, why do you want to play this game? He said, Dad, it really helps our program get great exposure on national television, the armed service game in Puerto Rico. I said, okay. And I started thinking. He said, give me 36 hours to think about it. And I went home and started thinking about it. I said, you know, my son's bright. Can't figure this one out. Why would he want to play Louisville? Then I realized Russ Smith just graduated. Luke Hancock just graduated. Stephen Van Treese just graduated. And Montrezl Harrell, our starting power forwards, going pro. That's why he's scheduling this game. He wants to beat his dad. Well, sure enough, my son, who I just visited yesterday, I said, what's Richard saying? He said, he expects to win, Dad. I said, he said that? Well, not to you, Dad, but he said it to me. I said, you ratted out on your brother? He said, you asked me what he said. So it's going to be quite interesting. And I'm real proud of him. And there's no loser in this situation because, obviously, if you lose, you're disappointed, but you got to get on to the next game because that's what happens on a one-day contract. And you're so proud of your son. If you win, you're happy for your team, but you don't like going to shake hands with a losing coach who's your son. So it'll be quite interesting. But I tell my team every day before we leave the locker room, guys, we got one practice. That's it. We have one practice on a one-day contract. See, tomorrow when you sign on to this one-day contract, you're going to step over the lines of a basketball court. And you're on. 1 2-hour and 15-minute practice, or 1 12-hour day, or 1 10-hour day, whatever length you have, to show everybody around you you're enthusiastic, you're passionate for what you do. You're passionate, hungry, and driven. You have a PhD. You're a great listener. You'll never fall into that trap of technology, of taking out a phone in the midst of so many talented, significant people. You'll understand when to use it the right way. The force of focus, without being distracted, is the ability to reach your potential by paying attention to the task at hand. Can you just imagine if you're refereeing a game and some coach every single call is screaming at you? Well, there are coaches like that. How can that referee perform? Well, boy, am I glad today I didn't listen to negative people telling me negative things and I paid attention to my wife. Because once I signed on to that one-day contract, I've experienced things in the last 3 years that weren't there in the last 37 years. The ability to appreciate what I have, where I'm at, and who I'm with. Because I don't have blinders on anymore. I recognize everyone as significant, talented people, like everybody sitting in a chair in this audience. You have unbelievable potential, but stay humble, stay hungry, stay driven. Because once you do that, you enjoy every single day as if it's your last day working at that job because you're on a one-day contract. And when you go home at night, after you've had that incredible day, and it's not always winning days, it's an incredible day because of your passion and your enthusiasm. Then you become like me, extremely young, extremely humble, extremely passionate to meet the next person that I may encounter. And once you do that, you start winning more than you've ever won, enjoying what you do more than you've ever enjoyed, paying attention to people and meeting new friends that you never thought you would have in life. And it's really a lot of fun. I'm having, after my 41st year in coaching, an absolute blast at this profession. Now, a lot of you root for different pro teams and college teams. And I'm not going to tell you to root for the University of Louisville. But if you're looking for a second team to root for, I want you on my team. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Remember to visit the ISSA Resource Center booth at